long you're gone. I don't care how long you stay.
From the 1950s until his death, Muddy Waters literally ruled Chicago with a commanding stage presence that combined both dignity and raw sexual appeal with a fierce and emotional style of slide guitar playing. Waters was born McKinley Morganfield in Rolling Fork, Mississippi in 1915, but grew up in Clarksdale, Mississippi, where his grandmother raised him after his mother died in 1918. His fondness for playing in the mud earned him his nickname Muddy Waters at an early age. His first instrument was the harmonica, which he began learning when he was around 13. He played country suppers for tips and food with a guitarist friend. Guitars were all around him in the Mississippi Delta. However, while he was still a teenager, he saw greats such as Charlie Patton and Son House perform. Son House was an especially strong influence on Muddy Waters' playing. He showed the youngster the rudiments of playing slide guitar with a bottleneck and impressed young Muddy Waters with his powerful emotional singing. Waters began playing guitar when he was 17, emulating two blues artists who were extremely popular in the South, both Son House and Robert Johnson. His thick, heavy tone, the darkness of his voice, and his firm manner were all clearly derived from Son House. But the embellishments which he added, the imaginative slide technique, and more agile rhythms were closer to Robert Johnson. In 1940, Waters moved to St. Louis, but returned to Mississippi a year later, where he played with Big Joe Williams and Son Sims. In the early part of the decade, he ran a juke house, complete with gambling, moonshine, a jukebox, and live music, which Muddy provided himself. Muddy's encounter with destiny took place in the summer of 1941, when John Work and Alan Lomax, two folklorists from the Library of Congress, came to Clarksdale. The two men were looking for the legendary blues guitarist Robert Johnson. Johnson, however, was dead and had been murdered years before. So, instead, on Sunhouse's recommendation, they found Muddy Waters at Stovall's Plantation, where Waters recorded two songs for the Library of Congress. Waters would later recall in Rolling Stone magazine, "Lomax brought his stuff down and recorded me right in my house." Muddy became very confident upon hearing his own voice on record. And later on, Lomax sent Muddy two copies of the pressing and a check for $20. Muddy has said that he carried that record up the corner and put it on the jukebox and just played it over and over and over. Lomax came back again in July of 1942 to record Muddy Waters again. In 1943, Waters headed north to Chicago in hopes of becoming a full-time musician. He lived with a relative for a short period while driving a truck and working in a factory by day and playing at night. Times were good in Chicago, and Waters quickly found an apartment. Big Bill Brunzi, who had been part of the Chicago music scene for years, introduced him around. With Jimmy Rogers on guitar and Little Walter on harmonica, Muddy began playing house parties around the South Side. They called themselves the Headhunters, as the trio would go around looking for bands that were playing who would let them sit in because they knew if they got the chance to play, they would upstage the main act. It was 3 years before Waters was finally able to record in Chicago. He recorded songs for Columbia Records, but the company never released any as records. In 1947, Waters got another chance when pianist Sunnyland Slim, whom he had been performing around Chicago with, was offered a session with Leonard Chess's Aristocrat Records. According to legend, Waters was delivering Venetian blinds when he heard that Slim wanted him to play on the session. Waters is said to have told his boss that he needed the rest of the day off because his cousin had been found dead in an alley. Waters played guitar with Sunnyland Slim on piano on the cuts Gypsy Woman and Little Anna May.
You know the gypsy woman told me that you your mother's bad love shot. Well, you having a good time now.
These songs were also shelved, but in 1948, Waters' I Can't Be Satisfied and I Feel Like Going Home became big, and his popularity in clubs began to take off. Soon after, Aristocrat changed their name to Chess, and Waters' signature tune, Rolling Stone, became a smash hit.
Well, I wish I was a catfish swimming in a deep blue sea.
The Chess Brothers would not allow Waters to use his own musicians in the studio. Instead, he was only provided with a backing bass by Big Crawford. However, by 1950, Waters was recording with perhaps the hottest blues group ever. Little Walter on harmonica, Jimmy Rogers on guitar, Elgin Evans on drums, Otis Spann on piano, Big Crawford on bass, and Waters handling vocals and slide guitar. The band recorded a string of great blues classics during the early 1950s with the help of bassist songwriter Willie Dixon, including such hits as I Just Want to Make Love to You and I'm Ready.
I'm ready, ready than anybody can be. I'm ready, ready as anybody can be. I am ready for you. I hope you're ready for me.
By the middle 1950s, he had all but abandoned the spare instrumentation of his earlier hits and replaced it with the rocking sound of the songs that would come to be most closely associated with Waters, such as Hoochie Coochie Man, Mannish Boy, and I Got My Mojo Working.
Got my mojo working, buddy. Just won't work on you. Got my mojo working, buddy. Just won't work on you.
Muddy headed to England in 1958 and shocked his overseas audiences with loud, amplified electric guitar and a thunderous beat. When R&B began to die down shortly after, Waters switched back to his older style of country blues. As English rockers like Eric Clapton and the Rolling Stones got hip to the blues, Waters switched back to the electric circa 1964. Muddy expressed great anger when he realized that members of his own race were turning their backs on the genre, while the white kids were showing respect and love for it. The years rolled on and Muddy Waters continued to record and tour, playing one-nighters at clubs or large shows and festivals. Muddy kept on keeping on. And in 1983, Muddy Waters passed away in his sleep. At his funeral, throngs of blues musicians showed up to pay tribute to one of the true originals of the art form. 2 years after his death, the city of Chicago honored one of rock and roll's founding fathers by changing the name of 43rd Street to Muddy Waters Drive. Following Waters' death, B.B. King said, "It's going to be years and years before most people realize how great he was to American music." So, who has Muddy Waters' crown? Someone should give it back and place it on the head of this true king of rock and roll.
The gypsy woman told my mother before I was born, "You got a boy child coming. He's gonna be a son of a gun. He's gonna make pretty women jump and shout. Then the world wanna know what this all about. But you know I'm here.